is, congratulations, Mom and Dad. Thanks for always being there. And thank all of you for being here. And I want to congratulate each couple for those that have been married and their and lost their spouse. Just want to congratulate everyone here that has experienced marriage and has been committed to each other. And my folks are a living example of what I believe to be God's original plan for mankind, that the two shall become one. And that is certainly my goal. And for us that have not been married very many years and those that are still to be married, I would hope that at least some of us would remember this day. And I'm not singling out my parents. There are several here today that have been married for 50 years plus. But just think about that in the context of God's word. And I would hope and pray that we have given us four kids, given my folks the greatest gift that they could want. That we all know the Lord in a personal way, have given our hearts and hearts to Jesus, and that as a family of six, that we're all on the, by the grace of God, we continue to stay on the train bound for glory land. And there is many people today that experience happiness through material possessions, maybe good jobs, good wages, but true happiness comes from having Jesus in the home, in the hearts of people. And with that, I will sing, O Happy Home.
Chance to also join some of the remembrances. When I think about Irene, I think about the time when you changed for together, and I'll forever remember Bud Johnson when he said, "I always like to come to do Saddle and Andrews because our meals at Irene's are like a feast." And he always, that was a high point of his Saddle filling in New York, he could come and eat the meals that Irene prepared.
Those meatballs.
Oh, yeah. And I think that others have mentioned, let's see now, what was it? The angel food cake made with the yolks and the whites. Some people separated, but Irene didn't. She used to be scrumptious. And then how about the oatmeal bars? You ever tasted them? And Esther brought up something interesting. She was Ladies' Aid president one time. And as you know my wife, she's got a mind going here and there all over the place. You call it kind of scatterbrain. But she was so busy. And Irene was what we would call a Barnabas. You know what Barnabas was to Saul? He was his helper. He was his reminder. So Irene, at that time, was a reminder to my wife. She was the Barnabas, and Andrew is poking her now. Maybe she meant Barnabas to Andrew, too. She's been very patient. So, this is what I remember about you, Irene. And of course, there's a lot of other things. Maybe somebody else will spend something else on. Well, Andrew. He's the oldest of the family. He didn't know any English when he started country school. He was well-versed in Norwegian and still is. He can communicate in Norwegian and write Norwegian. And as a child growing up in the family, working with Dad and Andrew, myself together, I'd hear these Norwegian phrases spoken between them. And of course, the brain is this way that it assembles them so we can use them sometime. We got to Norway, I'd repeat these Norwegian phrases. And I could communicate real well in Norway with them because of having heard this all my life. And when we got there in our home community in Norway, at Verdal, they said, "That's the way we used to say it." It changed a little bit. And language is always in flux. It changes. You know about that. Andrew was the reader. He was the storyteller. I remember at home we used to do chores first, and then we'd have supper, we call it, not dinner, supper. And while Mom and the girls were washing dishes, Andrew would have a magazine in his hand, and she'd tell Andrew to read aloud. So he'd read to us. Mom would have read many school books to us at the, after the supper meal. I remember that too, but I remember Andrew reading out of different magazines. Instead of playing games, he had his nose in the magazine or a book. And at night, you know, we didn't have a room for each one of us. We had the boys' room and the girls' room. You friends with that? Well, Andrew and I had the boys' room together, and I was a lot younger. And Andrew used to tell me stories, so I'd go to sleep. And he didn't tell me stories. I was really mad. But he was a great storyteller, and as he was drifting, I was drifting off to sleep, it'd be Andrew telling me stories. And Andrew is one who we all will say is the one who remembered. Is there any subject that Andrew can't relate you on? What a blessing to have a memory and remembrance. One of God's gifts to us. And he certainly has shared it in his lifetime. When Andrew and I traveled together to Israel, we got to meet a lot of different people, just because Andrew's not bashful about speaking to strangers. He'd go up to them, and he'd get their name, and he'd write them a little book. Before you know it, there's a big conversation is going on. And this one fellow said, "Come on up to my apartment when you get time." So he gave us the number, and we sought it out. Sure enough, we had a good little, some refreshments there. And just because he wasn't afraid to speak to strangers. And you witnessed that, all of you folks here. And then he remembers their names afterwards, too. One day he was at Rolock, the tragedy, and he went up to this valley to tell you was of the Arab countries, Israelis or whatever, and he said, well, what's your name? And I can't remember his name, so Andrew could tell you right now, you know he could. But he said, well, that was the name of our bus driver in Israel. And he said, that's my brother. Isn't it amazing? Andrew and I worked together. I can say that Dad and Andrew maybe taught me how to work because I maybe like to play, being younger. But we pitched lots of manure together. We had chicken barns to feed, and we had horse barns to feed in the summertime. In those days, you know, we did it with a fork, and we did it on a rainy day or some day, and it'd pile up, and lots of ammonia. And we'd take a deep breath and run. Get a fork full and run out and throw the manure spreader. We'd then take another deep breath. You experienced that, Werner? Chicken barns, ammonia. Well, anyway, we worked together, and we worked together in the woods, and whatever he did, it was maybe shocking grain. We shocked grain for, first Andrew shocked most of our own grain for Dad and all the binder men around the factory, and then we shocked grain for the neighbors. Albert Yates, we shocked all of his grain one year, I know that. And it was fun. And Andrew is the one who is a giver. Have any of you experienced any of Andrew's giving? That's another gift of God. Aren't we blessed in the body of Christ, the church, having different gifts that support one another? We aren't all the same, but we can experience this unique family in the church, the body of Christ, where we can share and lift each other up with the gifts we have. Now, does somebody else like to come and take the mic? Clarence, I think that's something to say. Clarence, we'll honor you. We'll start it off with Clarence. Being I, you had to use the mic, you're going to have to do it.
Well, thank you. First of all, congratulations, Irene and Larson. This is a wonderful day. We're glad we could be here. I'm Clarence Quambeck, and I'm married to Andrew's youngest sister, Edna, and we live in North Dakota, and we've been down here, I think, about 40 years, 8 years now. I've been coming to Minnesota off and on. I came more often back 48 years or so, but anyway, we thank you for the fine fellowship we've had all these years, and even though I've been handicapped, the Larson family welcomed me into that family, and I've really had a lot of good fellowship. And of course, I married one of the best Larsons in the family. She has now lived in North Dakota for 48 years. Even before that, she came to North Dakota, and she has learned to appreciate it, and so I've had a hard time getting her to leave, but she's welcome to Osaka and visit her family. Thank you for this invitation to be here and share this day with you, and God's richest blessing on you in the future years and on your family, and thank you all.
Anyone else? Okay. Werner Patterson.
survivors. There were eight of us. We always used to enjoy coming to Osage. As a matter of fact, I still do. And there was the Nelsons. There was the Larsons.
Weapons.
Weapons. And Arnie Larsons. Right? So, and we always had fun with nothing. I don't think they even knew what a net looked like until it was in high school. But when my folks left Minneapolis to retire into the Osage area down near the outlet, you remember that? And many young men, they had chickens. Right? So they did give. A lot. But I must tell you something else about Andrew. They weren't bashful to come to our house either. When they did come down to the city, they came to our house, as did the Roy's, as did the John Nelsons. And we enjoyed that immensely. And I remember one time, right in the heart of the Depression, Andrew came to our house. I think probably the first time. And came down at the State Fair time. Remember that, Andrew?
The only time I was to the State Fair.
Yeah. It cost a nickel to take the streetcar over to the division point between Minneapolis and St. Paul. The State Fair was grounds of St. Paul, many of you remember. And I'm sure I didn't have over a quarter. When you have eight kids, a quarter is a lot of money if you're going to give them. Each one of them. So we got to the State Ball, Minneapolis city limits. We still had a couple of miles to go to the State Fairgrounds, but we walked, if you remember that, Andrew. And we spent the whole day there taking in all the sights. And I suppose most of the day was on Machinery Hill, which meant nothing to me. And then at night we walked back again, dog tired, to the city limits and spent another nickel. That meant we had about 15 cents that day, just meant for something to eat, because I don't think we had any money to enjoy any of the rides or any of the sideshows. But it does also appear to me, if I remember correctly, we did get into the grandstand, and we did see some auto races. Is that right? And then also we saw something else. If any of you go down to the State Fair, and you look in their museum, you'll see a bunch of history over the past years for the fair. One of the things that happened when we were there that day was there was a fellow by the name of Billy Ash. And he took an airplane ride, I don't know how many feet up, maybe 2,000 feet. And when he was up there, the MC said to one of the clowns that was bouncing around with him, they said, Lozo, whatever your name is, I don't remember, how would you like to be up there in that airplane? Well, the clown says, I'll tell you this, I'd hate to be up there without it. Hilarious joke. I remember that. Plus the other thing I remember is the guy jumped out. That Billy Ash jumped out of that airplane with a sack of flour. Do you remember that, Andrew? He did. And when he jumped out, he was supposed to let that flour go so everybody could see him. And then got about halfway down, he was supposed to open the parachute and land somewhere on Machinery Hill. He landed on Machinery Hill, but the parachute did not open, and he was killed. So this is not something to laugh about, but it's always stuck to my mind. And that's part of the historical museum there at the fairground. But again, I want to make this especially something to remember, is that Andrew and Irene were always very, very giving, and they were especially giving to my folks. When they were at the lake, I don't know how many chickens and what else they brought over there, but it wasn't the time that my mother didn't say, now Andrew brought me this, Andrew brought me that. I think that was wonderful. Almost put me to shame because we tried too to bring them, but Andrew lived closer than we did. So that means a lot.
Thank you.
Yeah, I'd like to thank everybody for sharing this special milestone in Dad's life. And I share writing by Paul in 1 Corinthians chapter 13. Love is patient, love is kind. It does not boast. It is not proud. It is not rude. It is not self-seeking. It is not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrong. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. Love never fails. But where there are prophecies, they will cease. Where there are tongues, they will be still. Where there is knowledge, it will pass away. For we know in part, and we prophesy in part. But when perfection comes, the imperfect disappears. When I was a child, I talked like a child. I thought like a child. I reasoned like a child. When I became a man, I put childish ways behind me. Now we see but a poor reflection as in a mirror. Then we shall see the face to face. Now I know in part, then I shall know fully, even as I am fully known. And now these three remain, faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of these is love. Christ is the perfect example of unconditional love. And one of the attributes that Christ gives us as Christians is unconditional love. And that's one of the gifts that God has given Dad and Mom. Another attribute is a kind and forgiving heart. And for us as Christians, if we come to God and forgive us with our heart, that all the prophecies that have taken place and are to take place mean nothing when we meet God face to face. And it is so easy maybe to start taking special parents for granted. But one of the comforts in these times, when I think back, one of the comforts I can look back and know that Dad and Mom hung in there, and they didn't reject me, or they still loved me the same, whether all these circumstances. Thank you, Mom, Dad.
I'm kind of a stranger here, maybe not to all of you, but I had the privilege of being with you at your church, and Master Hilly would be away, and I got to know many of you. But when it came to meeting somebody almost right away, who do you suppose it was? Andrew Larson. You know, I'm even Andrew. I don't think no strangers, they're just friends they haven't met as yet. And he came up to me when I first came into your midst and greeted me and made me feel so at home, and the rest of you likewise. And I couldn't leave without getting a dozen eggs. Well, you worked hard for this, and you need this for you. No, he says, this is for you. And so you and your brother, sons and family members talk about parents who are giving. I've experienced that as almost a stranger coming into your midst, as I had the privilege of being with you for the Lord's Day when Pastor Hilly was away. And I just want to say what a blessing it has been to meet these here. can bring forth fruit in old age, and be green and full of sap, that's what the translation says. So we know that those dear ones are still bringing forth fruit in old age, and the joy of you would be in this special occasion.
Thank you very much.
Anyone else? Okay.
I heard that Andrew and Irene they never went to bed after during argument. They always stayed up and finished.
There were the old advance of that five brothers that retained and took a name. the others were either Anderson or Larson Johnson. Anyway, there's been a lot of music here today, and it's come right from this family. And I'm real grateful for that. Dad always said he started singing in choir when he was about 12 years old. And he sang in choir as long as he was in choir here, or he's able to. And we have recordings of Dad singing on tape a week before he died. So he was full of musical. Mom played the piano, the organ here for years and years, and Esther Burke, my sister, played. So there's been a lot of music that's come through this cuckoo today. Now we're going to have a few words by Jim Larson.
Well, I too want to congratulate Mom and Dad, and we've got a tape recording of Esther Burton and Bob, and Esther talks a little bit at first, just congratulating Mom and Dad, and then she turns it over to Bob, and Bob is a little more outspoken, so I'll play that at this time. Most of us older, middle age group now, we went to country school down here. It's been moved now to Jerry Hiltner. He's got the country school and it's really beautiful there. But it ended up that a lot of us went to school down there, and then we'd always walk down there, except if Norma Moss would give us a ride. But on the way back, a lot of times we were in a hurry to get home, so I usually run two pulse and walk one pulse, and run two pulse, walk one pulse. And whenever we got home, Mom always had usually two eggs, fried eggs usually, and pulse. We got to watch some comics, and we had to go do chores and stuff. And there too, when Bud Johnson was there, it was always chopping time, so it was out the door we went, and my brother John mentioned too, Bud's favorite thing was our favorite meatballs there. And Mom always, we always offered Bud some catsup, but Bud said, no, he says, I don't use catsup. If you can't appreciate the taste of meat, you know, without catsup, then it's not worth eating. Mom always was a good cook, and she was always there for us, as, you know, because she never worked out of the home, but she worked very hard in the home and taking care of us boys. But she wasn't always that softy either, because my younger brother Carl, John was a little older, so we didn't have too many squabbles with her. But Carl and I, we kind of got into it. And it ended up that when Carl and I would kind of have our go-arounds, Mom had to lay the law down, because Dad was usually out visiting someplace. We'd be working to it. Mom had two yardsticks. I don't know if she had a synchronizer, but she'd grab one. We liked the floppy ones. They didn't hurt us hard, but she had another one called, it was a bulk one. And that one's actually broke. But that one really left its mark, so we kind of scrambled for that. And then the other thing what Bob mentioned was Mom and Dad met in the hospital room. And Mom was a nurse there, or a helper's aide. I don't know if she can consider herself a full-fledged nurse, but she was a helper's, and she did a good job there. And let's see, Roy, now, did you carry Dad? He had an appendicitis, right?
You sure did? I can tell you the rest of the story, too.
Okay, I'm going to turn over Roy a little bit here. At first, I'm going to just let up Roy speak. I got a little more to say then.
Well, I tell you, there's no game word here, is there? There was one sport that Andrew and I did together. Fishing. In the spring, with a spear. The only time of year we fished that we really didn't have a bad conscience. We never spent time of fishing. There were a lot of suckers down there. Once in a while there was some too that didn't really look like suckers. No, none of them ever went to waste. Now Andrew wasn't feeling very good. And I wasn't there that night, but he went fishing down by the river. He really shouldn't have gone. When I came, see, I lived with Mom and Dad over at where Bill does now. When I came over there, we still worked together. I came over there and he was just bent over, you know, and I said, you are going to the hospital. No, he didn't want to go. I said, you change your overall and get a clean overall, I'm taking you out there now. Well, he had an appendicitis operation. Believe it or not, he has some of my blood running in his veins. In those days, they just kind of
transmit your information to another. And of course, that's where you So he was really glad that you went fishing that night, even if he didn't. And now you know the rest of the story.
Yeah, there's a little more to the story then. You see, Dad was kind of all of it. I suppose it's the date of them. Well, the first thing he saw was Mom, of course, and her wife and stuff, and he thought for sure he'd die and go off to heaven. Mom, of course, had to live up to that. He took care of him all through those years, and Dad really worked hard. You know, he taught us boys, and my sister, too. She puts a lot of long hours in, and we really worked hard in our day, but Dad always was, you know, maybe... You know, how do you say, tired after the long day, but Dad never seemed to go to bed right away. He usually liked to sit and read. And then when us boys would go out and stuff, and I remember I got into roller skating and stuff, and we'd go on parties afterwards and have a bite to eat. And it'd be 2 o'clock before he rolled in, but we're behaving ourselves though. But Dad would always be there, and Dad and I could talk and stuff, and he'd be 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning, and he's always reading a book and studying and stuff and underlining things. And if anybody's ever gotten reading material from Dad, it'll always be underlined, highlighted, pointed out to read this page, and I really appreciate that. I don't pick up on a lot of what he reads. He reads some pretty serious stuff to us. But I really enjoyed growing up in our household. We never had strict curfews, you might say, but it was a good household to grow up in. And they're good grandparents, and we get to have our grandkids come over there, and they take care of them and stuff too. So I'll turn it back over to Roy.
Turn it over to Kathy. She's next.
Okay, Kathy's next.
Yeah, thank you so much for Mom and Dad for the blessing you've been to my daughter and to our family. And I know there was many a time when the children were little that you took care of them for us, and it's been a real joy to get together, always living close by, and everything too. And I want to thank everybody that had a part in this program. You know, it's gotten kind of long, but I hope you all enjoyed it, and Mom and Dad for the time that we've had to share these moments with you. And, now I'm just going to direct you after our program is over here. We'll have Mom and Dad go down in the foyer out there, and then you can congratulate them, and then the rest of you can just follow, and there are refreshments in the basement that you can all come down and enjoy, and just enjoy the rest of the afternoon. And thank you so much, Roy, for emceeing this, and everybody that had part of it. Thank you so much.
I've had a lot of fellowship with his sons.
But I'd like to leave you with this. They said I was to have devotion, a devotional speaking at the end of the meeting. And I'd like to share with you a song that I think is a good example of the Larson family, the Andrew Larson family. Well, it goes for the rest of the Larsons too, for that matter, but we're talking about Irene and Andrew tonight, or this afternoon. The 128th Psalm says this: "Blessed is everyone who fears the Lord, who walks in his ways. You shall eat the fruit of the labor of your hands, you shall be happy, and shall be well with you. Your wife will be like a fruitful vine within your house. Your children will be like olive shoots along your teeth. Lo, thus shall a man be blessed who fears the Lord. The Lord bless you from Zion. May you see the prosperity of Jerusalem all the days of your life. May you see your children's children. Peace upon Israel." I think this song tells pretty well the proof of the Irene Andrew Larson marriage. I think I know all of their children, and I don't know one of them who is not active in the kingdom. I'm thankful for that. I like to talk to people about things like this, and once in a while I have told them about the man I knew who had sons and daughters whose grandchildren are active in the kingdom. No greater tribute to be given. And so we're thankful to be here, to see so many. You know, Andrew has a little hobby kind of thing, you know. He disappears sometimes all day. Guess where he is? He's in an office. And he brings home the fruit of his trip. One of his sons once told me, "I wish Dad wouldn't go to those auctions so often. He brings stuff we can't ever use. Who knows about it?" But that's Andrew. That's Irene. That's their sons and daughters. As far as I know, each of them is active in the important business of the world of Christians. Active in the kingdom. You can't be more thankful for that, brother. You can give praise. And those of you who know me know I have a nasty habit. I can't stop crying. I have to weep. Tears of joy to an old man like that, a woman like that. Father, we thank you for your presence today. We thank you that you know our needs. And so we pray for them, Lord. We pray for those who could not be here because of health problems. And so we bring Esther before you, Lord. Oh God, bless her and heal her. Bless this couple, Lord, that they might continue to share their love for thee. For we ask it in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen." I think I'm the last on the program, is that right? Well, will the congregation please rise?
I was going to say,
she's not very well. She hardly ever gets out of the house anymore. She has been diagnosed with congestive heart failure a year or so ago, and she's on oxygen most of the time. But I just wanted you to know that, but that's why I'm recording here. Bob and my mother used to exchange poetry, and Bob is pretty good at poetry. You might agree. Mom was pretty good. But in her youth, back and forth. Okay. The time.
That I'll be forever grateful for is the voice that I've got. And whenever people thank me for singing and sharing, I try to remember to tell them that the glory goes to God. Because like Roy mentioned a few times, we all have gifts. Well, it's truly a gift from the Lord. And then one more comment, I noticed a number of people with tears today. And as the years have gone by, it's become easier for me to shed tears. And for those of you that have learned to do that, you know there's not a more tranquil, peaceful feeling. And it wouldn't surprise me if some of you have had faith on Ida Clutman share with you to let the tears flow. Let the tears flow. So with that, we'll sing the Lord's Prayer.
Give us this day our daily bread. Look at the pants around.